Hotep family, bonjour. My name is Kaba Hiawatha Kamene. I had the pleasure of being part of a documentary titled 1804, The Hidden History of the Haitian Revolution. This revolution is very important for us to understand as a people. It's important for us to understand its impact on world history, and it's important for us to understand it as American history in this hemisphere. The impact it had on the African peoples worldwide is still being felt today. I'll have the opportunity to come out to Fort Lauderdale to speak at the African American Research Library, 2650 Sistrunk Boulevard, on Saturday, March 9th, 2019. There's a great deal that we have to talk about, not just its impact yesterday, but also today, but most importantly, for tomorrow, for our children, and for those yet to be born. We must prepare the future for them. For more information, call 720-839-8721 or 954-588-1964. Come on out on Saturday, March 9th, 2019, to the African American Research Library. We have things that we have to talk about. Hotep. Sek passe.
If you want to defeat your enemy, or if you want to overcome your oppressions, you have to think like your enemy. You can't think like you. Because if you think like you, the results that you're going to get are never going to be in your favor because you're not thinking like those who are coming against you. And quite frankly, family, I have to tell you, if I were them, those who would wish to oppress us, I would do the same thing. When you stop and think about how fragile they are, what is happening in our history today, 2019, is so important. What is happening today is one of the greatest gifts that we could be given, whether we realize it or not. Humpty Trumpty sat on that wall. Humpty Trumpty's going to have a great fall. And all the king's men and all the king's forces ain't going to put Humpty Trumpty together. But as a people, we have to teach our history. We have to teach the ties that bind us together. In 1804, the documentary that was done, as you know, this I sat for close to 3 hours taping, as all of the participants did. So you can see that maybe 20 minutes was taken out of each person to create the whole piece. But one of the questions that I was asked, as an African American, my father's from Alabama, Booker T, that was my name prior to becoming a born again African. Booker T. Coleman, father from Alabama, my mother's from Boston. The question was, what does IED mean to you? There are ties that bind us together. There may be French spoken. French is as much your language as English is mine. When you get deep back down inside of it, what we have done to English is what Patois did to French. What Puerto Ricans did to Spanish. We Africanized it. And it becomes so, that's why I'm so happy that our young people are here and that they follow up with this information, because just as they never taught you that history, they never taught you really the history of IED. My advantage was I grew up in a project in Manhattan, New York. And in my particular project, the Amsterdam Houses, those of you who know New York know Lincoln Center, it's that housing project right across the street. We had neighbors who were from Puerto Rico, Haiti, Barbados. So we had a richness of African culture, and everybody came together in a certain way. So on Sundays, my mother would cook kidney beans and rice and fried chicken. Our Puerto Rican neighbors would cook arroz con pollo y habichuela. And our neighbors from IED would cook poo and rice and peas. And what I remember is we never talked about which dish tastes better. We just talked about how all of them together taste so good. We have to come together, family. And that's what IET means to me. IET represents a historical understanding of what happens when black folk ain't gonna take it no more.
I see.
And one of the books that we're gonna talk about, The Island of Memes, written by Dr. Wade Nobles, he said that the Haitian Revolution is unfinished. It's not done yet. There is still more work to be done. Not only was IED the first black democracy in this area, it was the first democracy in this area. Even America didn't have what IET had. America still doesn't have what IED had back then in terms of a formulation of an understanding of what it is to be free and to allow your participants to be free. And that's the history of IET, that all of us, whether you are from Puerto Rico, whether you are from the República Dominicana on the other side of that island, whether you're from any of the Caribbean islands, whether you're from any country in Africa, there is a lesson to be learned about what happened in IET. Not just that, but the economic system that was set up. This is another thing that we have to study. For the young people, my background is a teacher. In New York City, I started teaching. I started teaching in Gary, Indiana in 1977, just for you to get a background of what I'm about to say. And I taught high school, an all-black high school, Roosevelt High School, Gary, Indiana. And then I came back to New York in 1979, and I began teaching in New York City Board of Education in October of 1979. My primary license is in early childhood, so I was a kindergarten teacher, because one of the things that I came to realize is that if I could get to 4 and 5 year olds' minds, just as Dr. Clark got to mine, if I could get to their minds at 4 and 5, see, the deeper you go into this system, the more you buy into it. But when you are intercepted at a young age, and you are given your true history, such as what our young people are going to experience today, and probably in their home, they're understanding their greatness. They're not bombarded with all of these images of what they say is superior. When the entire time, those who claim to be so superior are doing everything to be like you. They risk their lives to lay on the beach to be brown like you. They cut up their body in order to get body parts that look like yours. The whole time they tell you how ugly your complexion is, they try to look like you. The whole time they're talking about your body, they're trying to get it like you. Yet we sit trying to look like them while they are trying to look like us. So I've come to a conclusion, this has to be a psychological thing going on. This has nothing to do with reality. This has to do with illusion. And if we can break that illusion in our young people to help them understand that that melanin in your skin, the texture of your hair, the width of your nose, the size of your lips are all gifts given to you by the Creator, because the Creator don't make mistakes. So obviously the original human being that was born was meant to reflect the Creator. And life comes out of heat. Like I told you, when I stepped off, when I was going to the plane yesterday, when I was going to LaGuardia Airport, I was walking through snow. I look around, all the trees are dead. There's no leaves up there. I'm nowhere near the complexion that I was in July. And that's because of the absence of the sun. This is this is science. This isn't personal. I'm not talking about superiority or inferiority. Dr. King was right. It is the content of your character. I've always believed that. I believe that to this day. I would be doing as much damage to our children as the damage they tried to put on us by making them believe, simply because of the melanin in your skin, that you are superior. You are superior because of the fact that everything that they have put on you, everything that they are doing to our brothers and sisters in IED, still they rise. It ain't over till we win. And it's important for us to understand that greatness. But because we're bombarded with all of these different things, we don't quite really fully understand. But we're getting there. Little by little, step by step. See, we have to separate. What I was talking about with our young people is that one of the things that I tried to teach our young people as it relates, you have to understand the difference between politics and economy. See, we're getting it mixed up. The political systems that we're talking about, the political system is what we call a democracy and communist. That's political. The economic is capitalist and socialist. The illusion that they have put on us, and what you're hearing them say now about socialism this or socialism that or socialism, but what they don't understand is that America is deeply socialist. Just ask the corporations. That's the biggest socialist system in America. That tax break they got, that was socialism. They confuse politics with economy, and then we think that there's something wrong with socialism, but they practice socialism every day. Medicare is socialism. Social security is socialism. They make it like it's evil, but they practice it every day. It's an illusion. The same way they got black folk thinking they're ugly, they got us thinking that there's an economic system out there that's gobbling us up, and it's not. IET had one of the most perfect economic systems that existed. as it related to what they wanted to do. Let me just say this, and then we're going to get into this presentation so that we can understand this from a perspective. I believe in small government, and I believe in big business. But the business got to be mine. That's what IT was developing. They were developing for the everyday people a business mindset, an entrepreneurial skill that all that you did, 25% would go back to you personally to take care of your families and your lives. 50% would go to business. But the business was your business, not the corporations. There's a difference. When they talk about little government, it's because they're trying to get the money to go to big business that don't belong to us. And then 25% would go to the government in order to run the government, whether it be health care or whatever it was. So that the economic system that IET was developing, called a democratic, political, socialism, which is economic, was the system they wanted to put in place, which makes a lot of sense when you're developing a civilization. He's got DVDs, CDs, he's got things to sell. That's his business. I've got books and DVDs and oil. That's my business. There are other vendors here who may be into catering. There are other businesses. That's business. The money you spend with them goes to developing their business. That's a good model. There's nothing wrong with that. But when the money we're making leaves our community and goes into theirs so they can become multi-trillionaires, that's a problem. That's socialism. But they'll get us to believe the socialism. They want to take our Social Security. They want to take our Medicare. They want to take the little bit that we have. And what's wrong with a people that would do that? You already got 99.8% of everything, and now you want the 2.2%.
Wow.
So family, what are we going to do? We're going to educate our children. Because the African tradition demands that the society works in order to make it better for the children. When you study the African model of education, the work that we do as the adults is to make their life better. Everything we do is looking towards the future to make their life better. Now, please, if I could get a chair. What I want to do is I want to go through this and I want to talk to you. I like PowerPoint. But sometimes PowerPoint gets in the way. So I hope you understand that I'm going to mix it up a little bit. I'm going to do a little bit of presentation. I'm going to show you some things. And I'll also share this material with our brother, Khalid Williams, and the crew that brought me here. Because, family, this has been in the works for a long time. I don't know if you realize how long we've been working on. We've been working on this. Brother Khalid will tell you. Brother Patrick, Kenny, all of them. We've been working on this for about a year and a half. I was supposed to do this time last year. But it wasn't time. You know why? Because y'all wouldn't have been in this room right now. So it took a little bit of time to get y'all in the room. But now that we're here, let's talk.
All right.
What becomes important? Thank you. Not going to understand Haiti. We are not going to understand the African American experience in this part of the world, in this continent. We're not going to understand this if we don't understand something that happened in July of 710, 711, when Africans went into Spain and conquered Europe. None of this makes any sense if we don't understand the fact that in world history, we need to teach our children about the Moors. The Moors were Africans in 710 that left Morocco and moved into the southern part of the Iberian Peninsula. And for 700 years, until January 2nd, 1492, Africans ruled the world. Does my brother say he never heard this in class? I didn't hear this either. I heard this from Dr. Bennett, from John Henry Clark. And it becomes important that people that look like you rule the world. I know in our state right now, particularly with our young people having been exposed to the world that we're living in, it's hard for us to understand and see us as Africans telling people what to do. Because we've grown up in our lifetime with other people telling us what to do. So it's hard to put this in, but what I try to do is I try to present it in a way that you can understand this. Now, what I want to do is I just want to scroll through this because there's too much information. I'm going to share this material with Brother Khaled and with those that are interested in developing a program of education for our children, because I got an idea. And tomorrow is another day that we're going to do another present, but tomorrow's going to be about education. This is about content. The thing to realize in schools is there are two things that you're dealing with. One of the things you're dealing with is content, and the other is called intent. Content is what you teach. Intent is methodology or how you teach it. There are times that intent or methodology is more important than what you teach. There's a Moorish proverb that says, after you have learned what you set out to learn, you can throw that away because it was the process of learning it that was the greatest education. The process of education, how you learn, connects your neurons, your nerve cells. And as you are developing your nerve cells, it opens up and it creates memory banks in a part of your brain. And again, can't talk about it because I've got so much I want to talk to you about. So what I want to do is I just want to show you a couple of Portugal and parts of France. See, you can't understand IET if you don't understand what the Moors did in France. In fact, Napoleon once said that Africans were second to the Almohade. Africans ruled Spain and Portugal, and these are important dates. 719, Moors invade France. 837 AD, Moors capture Sicily. 846, Moors invade Italy. 1140, Moors leave France. Here is a map of Moorish Spain. It is bounded, if you can see my arrow up there, it is bounded by the Sierra de Guadarrama, which are the mountains of Guadarrama. They run diagonal across the Iberian Peninsula from Lisboa or Lisbon straight across. The Ebro River right here was their northern ground boundary. And then they came around, and all of this was called Al-Andalusia. Al means spiritual. In Spanish, andar. In French, what does it mean? Andre. Andar means to walk. And Lucia means light, luz. Al-Andalusia meant to walk in a spiritual light. Etymology, words, language is very important. Here's the geography of what we're going to teach our children. And here's the geography that we just went through. Okay. Here's a resource guide and text. Books to read. Here's an outline of how I present the case to our community. I've taught a college class, but they just said, no, you can't handle a course on Moors. You ain't coming up here with nothing on the Moors. So they said, you have to take this back to the drawing board and do it again. So then I went back and I wrote my syllabus again, and I said, the African presence in medieval Europe. They went, now that's okay. I taught the same class, didn't change nothing but the title. They're not very bright, you know. And you see, we all sit around and we know how bright we are. We know how brilliant we are. We watch what happens, family. You know that. We know that. You know, we're in a room with some of them sometimes, and like they do something silly, and I just look at brother, brother, look at me. We speak 1,000 words just like that. Okay, nobody in the room knows we're talking to each other. Yeah, I might hold up. That means, like, really, come on. Family, we have to teach our children. They must respect us. And when they see us in servant positions and they don't see us talking to them, and it's even on the plantation, we have a better plan than what we see happening today. And so these are some of the things that we talk about. The role that women play in the African community. Come on, forget that. You know, like I said, in 1804, you know. Like, if women ain't involved in your revolution, that ain't no revolution. That's nothing but a fist fight. You have a revolution when women are involved. See, because Cecile knows what to do. Okay? Desafis knows what to do. Okay, well, she said, brother, I'll take it from you. Brother, I got this. I got this. The city of Cordoba. Okay, so this is how we talk about Africans. This is before we get into our history in Haiti, before we get into our history here in America. And we're just gonna breeze through this, family, because I know that there's so many things that I want to talk to you about that I want to get into this, but I want to show you some other things so that you can understand that there is a curriculum for this. There is a way to teach this. And I'm not just coming theorizing. And it's important. There is a way we can teach our history to our community and to our children so that they understand from a foundational perspective, you are a good people. You don't have to go back to ancient Egypt for a classical African civilization. You can go to Haiti. Mm-hmm. Not just back then in 1804, but even now. Our brothers and sisters in Haiti are a classical African civilization. When you come back to us here in America, the African-American is a classical African civilization. You can go to Loisa Aldea in Puerto Rico. That is a classical African civilization. We tend to think we always have to go back to the past. Hip-hop is a classical African civilization. Hip-hop wouldn't exist if it wasn't for doo-wop. Doo-wop wouldn't exist if it wasn't for bebop. Bebop wouldn't exist if it wasn't for rhythm and blues to blues, blues to spirituality, and spirituals came from Africa. Mm-hmm. Our people, our young people have to understand, that's what I was trying to break to my son to help him understand the history of your music. You want some hip hop? Check out Gil Scott-Heron, yeah. Sonia Sanchez, yeah. Okay, Nikki Giovanni, The Last Poets. Yeah. Check out the brothers that used to kick the Thunderbird under the light and harmonize with Thunderbird. That's why, by the way. And we talk about the different dynasties, but there are some things that I want to talk to you about. Here's the city of Cordoba in Spain. The Moorish city of Cordoba, which is often regarded as the medieval world's most cosmopolitan and sophisticated city. Now, what I'm about to tell you is black people built this. Black people that look like you, look like me, built this. This sophisticated city, Cordoba in Spain, possessed in the 10th century, which is the 900, 1600 mosques, 900 public baths, 213,077 middle-class homes, 60,300 mansions, and 80,455 shops. You talking about entrepreneurs? We know business. We know black business. We gave it to the world. Wealthier homes consisted of two floors, a library, a garden, and running water. Her population was estimated between 500,000 to 1 million residents. The Spanish city of Cordoba in the 10th century was very much like a modern city today. Its streets were well paved, and there were raised sidewalks for pedestrians. So here we walk in the street, we think somebody else invented that. They took that from us. We brought that into Europe. We brought that into Europe from Africa. This is who we are. This is what we brought to the Caribbean. This is why you have to know this before you get into IED. Because if you don't let the school system teach our children that African slaves were brought, African slaves were not brought. Human beings were brought and they were enslaved. Because to a children's mind, a five-year-old, well, if you were a slave in Africa, it won't make sense that you were a slave here. You just pick up where you left off in Africa. African slaves were not brought from Africa. They were stolen. They were kidnapped, held in bondage. You know what's happening. It's right in front of us. When you go down there in Wall Street, okay, the largest plantation in the 1700s was in Brooklyn, New York. And when they used to bring Africans, for those of you who may know New York, there's a place called the Battery Park, which is where the boats come, okay? And when the ships would come in with Africans, they would take the Africans off the boat and they would go to sell them in Wall Street. But sometimes they had a lot of Africans, so they would have to put Africans along the road that they traveled, they would put Africans in prisons until it was time to bring them to Wall Street to sell. The ones that they brought, they would take to Wall Street and bring them down underground and put them in prison. You know, there are prisons under Wall Street. But the street that they used to put them in prisons before they would bring them today, what do you think that street's called? It's called Chambers Street. Mm. For those that know New York, you know Chambers Street that leads right to Wall Street. And then when they brought them up to sell, what do they sell in Wall Street today?
Stocks.
Stocks and bonds. Where did that word come from? Slave. We were livestock in bondage. Mm. So they just cut that down from livestock in bondage to stocks and bonds. Mm. It's right in front of us, family. Mm. It's crazy, isn't it? Yeah, it's crazy. Crazy like a fox. Because it's right in front of us, family. This is our history. This is who we are. Morris education. They brought the first libraries into Europe. They brought the first schools into Europe. The first universities. Okay, here they go right here. Africans started the University of Bologna in Italy in 1158. Montpellier in France in 1180. Oxford in 1200. In Valencia, Spain, 1209, the first music conservatory was brought by Africans into Spain. In Toulouse, in France, 1223. In Naples, 1224. African people look like you and look. Now, I know that's hard because we're so used to being the first at everything. Or I'm the first to graduate. No, you invented it. They just stopped you from going. And now all of a sudden you back, you think you first. There was a time they used to be very proud. I'm the first white graduate of Oxford. Cambridge in 1257. And then scholars from Cambridge and scholars from Oxford came to the United States and they traded with the Dutch. The British traded Suriname in South America. They gave that to the Dutch, and the Dutch gave New Amsterdam to Britain, and New Amsterdam became New York. And they built a college. And did Columbia University. We did this, man. This is historically documented. There are books on this. This is not something I'm making up, and I'm not saying this just to make myself feel good. I don't roll like that. I don't feel good about just trying to puff myself up and I don't have any evidence. I have to come to you as a community with evidence, scientific evidence that will back up what I say, because I don't want our young people to disrespect me just because I'm puffing up. This is what we did. This is who we are. And sad to say, but I got to tell you, everywhere that I study our history, from Kemeto, Egypt, to the Moors, to the Caribbean, to the plantations, to the civil rights movement, even to this very day we're living today, the forces of oppression have never been able to oppress us directly. They take advantage of us fighting amongst ourselves. Oh, you speak French, I speak English. Like that's a difference? We both African. The only difference between someone from Haiti, Puerto Rico, Jamaica, and Bronx, New York is a boat stop. There could be people from Haiti in this room that are related to me. Because the other thing to remember about San Domingue, that island, the combined island that we today call Haiti, Quisqueya, or the Dominican Republic, that was the breaking ground for the Spaniards, the conquistadores. That was the island that they broke. And what occurred was those warriors, those Igbo, Congolese warriors, the Ashanti warriors said, oh, we don't play that. So we crossed over the river into that one quarter of the island, and we were able to create maroon towns, maroon communities. And maroon towns and maroon communities led to the revolutionary forces of the revolution of Haiti. That's why y'all who are from Haiti, y'all are revolutionary. You're ready to go to war. You also love Africa, and that's what your strength is. You know, you ain't trying to be nothing else but African. Not that you may not have other bloods, because you got to honor whatever you are. But even the Polish and the Italians that fought in the revolution of Haiti said, I'm black. And that's what Desalines said. You want to stay here?
You black.
And the Polish people said, I'm black. Yeah, I'm black. So what was the fall of the Moorish Empire was that the families of the Moors were fighting amongst themselves. That's what brought them down. Say that again.
Divide and conquer.
Divide and conquer is the kingdom. Okay. Willie Lynch. Now, Willie Lynch never existed. That's a fairy tale. But I call it a syndrome because it's certainly alive and kicking amongst us today. So even if Willie Lynch is an illusion, it's a reality if you act like that. Now, you say, brother, show me some Africans. I'm going to show you some Africans. See, here in Belgium, they used to put our children in zoos. And by the way, this is 1958. I was around at this time. The whites are feeding her bananas like a monkey. And you know what's interesting? Monkeys don't eat bananas. You know, you give a monkey a banana, monkey look at it, what do I do with this? He throw it back at you. What am I do with this banana? I don't eat bananas. Bring me some leaves or something. No bananas. But this is where we are, family. Here, go starting up here. This is England. And this is royalty, by the way, Lady York. Here's Cheddar Man. Here's Monaco, down here. This is Italy. Bulgaria. Ukraine. All this talk about Ukraine. The original people were Africans in Ukraine. In fact, Africans were in Ukraine thousands of years before the invention of what we call the European or the Eurasian ethnic style. Because, you know, Eurasians are only about maybe 10,000 years old. They're not very old. They're very dumb, to tell you the truth. Africans have been around for millions of years. Here's Romania. That's what the first peoples of Romania look like. And up here, here's Russia. This is who we are. See, this is what I mean by sign. I want to show you. I want to show you photos that are taken out of, not our books, their books. See, this ain't our research. This is their research. Okay. Now, Alexander Dumas. Now, I'm going to tell you a story about Alexander Dumas. I'm not going to do it right now, but you see the brother Fro right up there? You see? Alexander Dumas, the author of... Now, for those of us who want to get spiritual, let me show you what the original Madonna and Child look like. All over Europe. These are all coming out of Europe. This one in particular, Our Lady of Czeslakova. Remember when Pope John Paul II went and kissed her feet? They didn't show you. They just showed you him on his knees kissing her feet, but they didn't show you the statue because this is what it looked like right here. Because then young people looking at that picture of the Pope kissing the feet of this black Madonna would have to say, is she black? Wait a minute, where is this? This is in Nigeria. No, this is in Poland. Look at all of them. This is the original. This is where they got the image of Jesus sitting in the lap of Mary. This is where it comes from. All of them, royal symbols coming out of Ethiopia. This is where it comes from. This is our history. Look at them closely. This sister down here got braids. This brother here got a little afro. And this is them. This is their cathedrals. This is not something I'm taking out. This is what's there. Look at it, family. She looked like you, sisters. With your little boy on your lap talking to you, or your daughter talking to you. This is who you are. Just something that we have to look at. Oh, now here's Hawaii. Now tell me if you have an aunt look like this. I have an Aunt Mabel look like this. That's my Aunt Mabel right there. She's the last queen of Hawaii. This is who was on the Hawaiian Islands. King Kamehameha was a brother with an afro. But they never show you the original pictures or the statues of him. They'll show you the redone ones. That's my Aunt Mabel right there. Y'all got aunts look like this. Mothers look like this. Yep. Hawaii was a black island. See how far back we have to go before we come to ID. This is what I want to talk to you about. Because then you'll understand why ID is doing what ID is doing and why you as people from ID or from Jamaica, or from Bronx, New York, do what you do. This is your legacy. And if you understand this, and if our children understand this, then they know where they got to go with their stuff. Okay, up here, I'm just gonna go to this. Here's Croatia. And here's the Russia again. And that's Germany. Africans in Germany. Rule Europe. Rule. We didn't take nobody told us what to do. We told them. And they did it because we did it with honor and integrity. This is another thing that's very important to understand. The reason why Africans were able to do what they did was because they brought intellect, technology, and all the good things. They brought soap into Europe. Because they don't wash. Woo! That's why, you know, that's why you see 7/10 was the first invasion, and then 7/11 was the second invasion, because Tariq came back and told Tariq, yo, man, you better drink some soap on your hand, because you're going to get sick of you. Man, we haven't got some communicable disease. They sneeze on you, man, for 6 months you'll be coughing. And they said, why are you at it, man? You need to bring some of that Al-Kool you left there. Spiritual water, Al-Kool. Because after they wash, man, teach them how to disinfect themselves. Mm. We call it today alcohol. Mm-hmm. Al-Kool, A-L-K-U-H-L, was spiritual waters. Al, spiritual, cool, water. Al-Kool was what you disinfect yourself with. Mm. They brought strawberries, Valencia oranges. They taught them how to make wine. They brought hops and barley that taught them how to make beer. So that it becomes important that we understand for our young people, understand they brought agriculture in. Olives, Moors brought that. Terraced farming, Moors brought that. People that look like you, people that look like me, brought this into you. We're a great people. We really are a great people, and our children have to feel this. And I'm hoping our young people are feeling this conversation. Ancestors did. There's nothing you can't achieve when you set your mind to it. You only have one enemy in the world, young people. And that enemy is that internal voice inside of you of negativity that is trying to convince you you can't do what you want to do. Mm. And then everything outside is not your enemy. It's your obstacle that you just got to get over. You understand what I'm saying? Because we say the white man an enemy. The white man ain't an enemy. He's an obstacle. We just got to get over him. We've done a pretty good job these past 500-600 years, despite what we've been through. Peoples of European descent are not our enemy. They're our obstacle. Our enemy is that voice inside that keeps telling us they are superior to us. Mm. When we know our history, when we know what we've done, there's nothing you can't achieve if you put your mind to it. If you can visualize it, you can actualize it. And you got to know that. You got to walk your life with that understanding, because that's what our ancestors had on their minds. But nothing going to stop. That's key. Our ancestors in chains, brought here against their will. Come on. The first thing they did, you know, and when we look at the border today with our brothers and sisters from Central and South America, from Mexico, we're shocked. But why are we shocked? What did they do to us? Didn't they separate us from our family? Didn't they put us in cages? Dr. Clark would say to me, if I were to say to him, he'd say, I'm surprised that you're surprised. If they don't treat you right, what make you think they're going to teach you right? Mm. If they don't treat you right, what makes you think they're going to teach you right? Mm. Why would they teach you to empower yourself? Right. They would have to be out of their mind to do that. My problem is, they're doing what they're supposed to do. But are we doing what we're supposed to do? Mm-hmm. See, we're going to church now. When I hear somebody say, well, no, we're in church now. This is real family. Okay, now. Let's do this. Here's my PowerPoint. Okay. Here are some people. Chevalier Saint-Georges was born in 1745. He died in 1799. His mother was from Martinique, and his father was a French noble. His father brought Chevalier Saint-Georges to France.
Seeking salvation, they moved to the States, a risk many are willing to take, and the ones that do, by example, lead. And that brings us to where I was conceived, a place called Brooklyn, New York. Yeah, I was born there, but still had the fear of acknowledging my true Haitian culture. I moved to Queens when I was 6, and the same mind tricks that called me refugee haunted me and made me not want to be Haitian. So how can I smile when my people are being made fun of? I'm asking my fellow peers, where's the love? Silly stereotypes been stabbing my self-esteem, trying to submerge me in the strong currents of the Atlantic. When my parents would go to parent-teacher meetings, I'd panic. Because when you heard my father's heavy Haitian accent, that meant that I'd be the joke in the class the next day in school. Boat people, refugee, just to name a few, what was I supposed to do? So I crawled back in my shell, all the while still in denial of all of the rich history that Haiti had to offer to the world. It wasn't until I moved to Miami and I was already in my teens, I found out Haiti was the first independent black nation in the world. Yeah. In the Antilles, we were considered the pearl. Yeah. So I started to research, archive historical events and facts that may have fell through the cracks. No longer will I hide behind these silly stereotypes that would denounce the legacy of my ancestors. Now I'm conducting educational workshops to the youth that once thought like me. I wasn't born in IET, but IET was born in me. Perplexed and ashamed, not being able to speak the language, trapped in bondage, off to the land of the free, home of the brave. Sounds like IET to me, but they still telling lies to me. The first independent black nation in the world. We put fear in the eyes of the oppressors, second guesses, but didn't think twice to rally after dark and put the spark in the hearts of malignants. While they were killing infants, we never once complained of shin splints. Mm. The people's army, they saw me with a vision beyond 2020. Many didn't make it, but many did. We read psalms and sang songs of revolution. Freedom or death! I quote the words of Toussaint Liberté de Lamour. We fought for much more than our freedom. With one foot shackled to the earth, we gave birth to new horizons, rising high, high off life, high off pipes, packed with prosperity as we moved merrily across the lawn from dusk till dawn while we fought for our freedom. While we fought for our freedom. While we fought for our freedom.
Waterfall, lush vegetation, blue water. Could it be Cuba, Jamaica, Trinidad or Martinique? No, it is Haiti.